Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anurekha Charivag, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. I am coordinating the paper on Sociology of Gender. In this module on Dalit Feminism, we are going to focus on how caste is a defining factor within Indian society. Further, we will also focus on the work of Professor Gopal Guru, who has argued that the category of Dalit has to be historically located and sociologically developed and designed and understood. Further, drawing upon the works of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who has argued that women are the gateways of caste system and it is the close nature of the caste that is based on the sexual exploitation of women, especially the Dalit women, that has formed the basis of recognition and necessity of Dalit feminism in India. Section 1. Dalit Feminism, an overview and Dalit feminist standpoint. An important debate with regard to Dalit feminism is an argument of Dalit women speaking differently. In this section, I have drawn most on the arguments from the works of Gopal Guru and Sharmila Rege, whose arguments and theorizations have played a crucial role in shaping the debate on Dalit feminism and Dalit feminist standpoint. The main proponent of this debate is Professor Gopal Guru, who had theorized on the need to analyze the issues of Dalit women within their own historical location. Why was this needed? In this context, the argument of Chakravarti is relevant, where it is argued that when the state interventions are gender blind or lacking gender sensitivity, lower caste Dalit women are not only exploited and marginalized by upper caste Brahminical patriarch, but Dalit women are also marginalized by mainstream feminist movements. Guru states that Dalit women justify the case of speaking differently on the basis of external factors, that is, non-Dalit forces homogenizing the issue of Dalit women, and internal factors, the patriarchal domination within Dalit. Social location determines the perception of reality. The responsibility of Dalit women issues of non-Dalit less valid and less authentic. Guru states that for Dalit activists, caste factor does not get adequate recognition in the analysis done by non-Dalit middle class urbanized women activists. Claim for women solidarity at both national and global level erases the contradiction that exists between high caste and Dalit women. Further, as Guru states, Dalit feminists rejected tokenism, protested at guest appearances, especially at conferences and campaigns, and consider feminist theory developed by non-Dalit women as unauthentic, as it does not capture the reality. As Rao argues, the Dalit Bahujan feminists have gone beyond merely arguing that Indian feminism is exclusive. Rather, they demand that for a rethinking of the genealogy of Indian feminism in order to engage meaningfully with the concerns of women's difference from the ideal subject of feminist politics in India. It is in this context Guru states that Dalit women's perception, while critical of the homogenization of a dominant discourse, does not make fetish of its own reality and therefore prevents the ghettoization of Dalithood. Such an awareness of the Dalit woman renders the theorization of experience and epistemology of knowledge emancipatory and liberating. Rege argues that the argument for Dalit women speaking differently is made in the context where feminist scholars have ignored and marginalized the contributions and interventions of women in the non-Brahmin woman. The invisibility of this history has led to scholars theorizing on the autonomous assertion of Dalit women as a different voice. Dalit women have always been vocal about their rights, but their voices have largely been ignored and erased. Rege et al. Argue that the efforts to develop a dialogue within diverse movements in India and solidarity between non-Dalit and Dalit feminists faced obstacles in the context of 1. Silence of feminists in the face of increasing violence against Dalit women, and 2. Failure to recognize structural violence of caste in linkage with sexuality and labor. Thus, the demand for Dalit perspectives is grossly and inadequately represented within mainstream Indian feminism. As Rege argues, the task is to map the ways in which the category of woman is being differentially reconstituted within regionally diverse patriarchal locations cross-hatched by graded caste inequalities. We also need to look at the potential of Dalit feminist knowledge in Maharashtra and is being validated as an epistemic term by drawing the challenges it poses on Indian Brahminical leftist and mainstream feminist ideologies, argues Patil. Dalit women challenge the totalizing nature of feminist culture that does not condemn oppression and tangible and non-touchable forms of violence based on caste gender structures. Further, while Raj Rejecting on the experiences of politics in Kerala states that though Dalit men and women were part of the most visible forms of public action, they remained invisible in both the discourses and the organizational structure of leftist politics at all levels. In a similar vein, Namala argues that Dalit women raised the issue of caste, which remained marginalized in debates and practices of the existing movements. The practice has been to club Dalit women's issues under one caption of women's issues and discusses them in general terms. Such invisibility was one of the reasons which gave a push to the rise of Dalit feminism in India. Further, as Raj argues, the interventions and demands raised by the Dalit women activists were articulated by the mainstream feminists in a patronizing, generous manner. Raj states that feminists, through the mention of caste and class, they do it only rhetorically. There has been a deliberate attempt to appropriate the newly emerging criticisms in order to be politically correct and address caste and gender in a token form. Such an attitude by the mainstream feminist, I believe, would not lead to building of solidarity among them, rather would push the Dalit feminist more into the margin. It was inclusion without being inclusive. While the factors are analyzed, it is very clear that Dalit women have not been integrated into this analysis and focused on. Further, as Raj states that Dalit women activists are raising demands of the general rights sort, but they do not easily fit within the set of demands that prior women's movements have been raising for the last two decades. For instance, by prioritizing the question of land for Dalit women, these activists are challenging the agenda of contemporary mainstream feminism in the Kerala context. In fact, the emergence itself is a critique of mainstream discourse on rights and social equality, and in this context, Rege says that it was in the 1990s that one could observe the rise of autonomous Dalit women's organizations at the regional and national level. What does such assertions imply for the women's movement? According to Rege, such assertion has raised questions with regard to theoretical political issues and how highlighting the Brahmanism of the feminist movement and the patriarchal practices of the Dalit politics. The following paragraphs would discuss a debate on the Dalit women's experiences being different and the Dalit feminist standpoint. In the end, questions have been organized as one more standpoint, thereby institutionalizing a perspective within this framework of difference that the issue of caste becomes the sole responsibility of the Dalit women's organization. Thus, if it is caste, then it is the Dalit feminist who should deal with it. As Rege argues, an absence of an exploration of each other's position hinders a dialectics both of a revisioning of the contemporary feminist politics and sharpening of the positions put forth by autonomous Dalit women's organization. She argues that an assertion of Dalit women's voices is not just an issue of naming the difference. Naming of difference leads to a narrow identitarian politics. Rather, this assertion is to be read as centering of the discourse on caste and gender and is viewed as suggesting a Dalit feminist standpoint. Rather, what one needs is a shift of focus from difference to multiple to be converted into oppression, understood in the context of different hierarchies of class, gender, race, and so on, and thus transforming the difference into a standpoint by historicizing the difference. How do we then historicize the difference? Rege argues that this is to be done by mapping and putting on record the voices and contributions of non-Brahmin women in the movement and the intervention of radical social revolutionaries such as Mahatma Phule, Savitribai Phule, Tarabai Shinde and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. As Pardeshi argues, Dr. Ambedkar looks at specificities of women's subordination both as Dalit and as a woman. In this context, Rege argues that based on a review of these works, it is clear that difference or different voice of the Dalit woman is a reflection of the long-lived experience of everyday struggles, but unfortunately, as mentioned above, these voices have remained invisible to both the women's and the Dalit movement in India. Whereas in the Dalit movement, the Dalit woman's voices and experiences were being framed in the context of the role as a mother and the victimized sexual being, in the women's movement, all women came to be framed as victims and therefore Dalit, leading to the universalization of the middle class, upper caste women's experience subsumed under the larger idea of sisterhood. Thus, while Dalit movement did not interrogate gender, women's movement did not engage with Brahmanism, leading to the invisibility of Dalit women's experiences and everyday struggles. It is because of such erasure of experiences that a feminist politics organized in the context of the articulation of the marginalized communities could not emerge, leaving the movement fragmented and limited. In the context of Guru's argument of Dalit women speak differently, Rege argues that though one recognizes the need for Dalit women to locate their experiences, but to frame their knowledge on the basis of direct experience will limit the revolutionary potential of the movement and its epistemological standpoint. What is necessary in this context is to theorize a difference by going beyond it, leading to Dalit feminist standpoint. A Dalit feminist standpoint is seen as a man emancipatory as it places emphasis on the individual experiences within socially constructed groups and focuses on the hierarchical, multiple, changing structural relations of caste, class, and ethnic, and is also open to liberatory interrogations and revisions. In this argument, it is not to argue that non-Dalit feminists can speak as or for the Dalit woman, but they can reinvent themselves as Dalit feminists. Such a position steer clear of limited perspective of direct experience, authenticity, and identity politics. As Rege states, adopting a Dalit feminist standpoint position means sometimes losing, sometimes revisioning the voice that we as feminists had gained in the 1980s. This process, we believe, is one of transforming individual feminist into oppositional and collective subject. In a critique of the Dalit feminist standpoint, Kapadia, who has researched extensively on the issues of Dalit women in Tamil Nadu, in a review of the pioneering work of Sharmila Rege, Writing Caste, Writing Gender, states that reading through the book reveals that there is a radical difference between the lives of the Tamil Dalit woman that is based on her research and Marathi Dalit woman based on the writing of Sharmila Rege. Thus, she has argued that it is impossible to speak of a universal homogenized Dalit standpoint, cultural values. Such a position suggests that it is equally impossible to speak of any universal homogenized Dalit standpoint, as many of the feminists, including Rege, have argued for a Dalit feminist standpoint. Kapadia further states that though such standpoints are desirable, the social reality is so diverse and always in constant change and transition, so it is not theoretically and methodologically feasible to have a universal Dalit feminist standpoint. Datar, on reviewing the idea of difference, argues that the focus of difference and identity ignores the centrality of economic exploitation and market fundamentalism disenfranchising women. Thus, one needs to locate exploitation of Dalit women in the domain of economy rather than identity politics. Section 2. Dalit Feminist Autobiography, Analysis of Urmila Pawar Zaidan. Urmila Pawar was one of the most prominent Dalit feminist writers and also one of the pioneers of the Dalit feminist movement. Her autobiographical work, Ayadhan, could be examined as a testimony of the everyday struggles of a Dalit woman, especially as a member of the Mahar caste. The title is symbolic, as Ayadhan represents the primary occupation of the Mahar community, which is the weaving of baskets and utensils the community used. This was a primary source of income for the community. Further, weaving in this book is used as a central metaphor, indicative of the position of the lower rungs of the caste system and their crippling poverty. What does this work represent? One sees a life of a Dalit woman through a Dalit woman's eyes, her perspective while engaging with the personal and the public. Further, it reflects on the woman's struggle to find her identity and a sense of fulfillment, particularly in the background of communal tensions, caste inequalities, patriarchal attitude of the community, and family towards women. The autobiography gives a detailed account of the exploitation of Dalit women had to suffer in Ayadhan. The book vividly described the hardships of Dalit women had to bear. The difference in the food habits and the food itself was an indicator of how different and how much more privileged Brahmin lives were. Dalit women were much more poorly fed than men, and this was reflected in the meager amounts of food described in detail by Pawar. Lower castes were humiliated regularly in public during weddings and, as mentioned in the regressions, even in school environments. Pawar observes that these prejudices were passed down to her Brahmins classmates at a very early age, due to which they would not let her touch the pot while they collectively cooked a meal in the school. After the meal, her eating habits were made fun of. This highlights a cultural inheritance, which is a sort of initiation into caste-related prejudices for the children, and the fact that they would poke fun at poorer people for their eating and living habits. The book provides an exploration of Pawar's life as a Dalit woman and how she was made aware of the stark differences between her life and that of the other higher caste. The rise of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's philosophy and his public denouncement of Hinduism and Manusmriti was welcomed by the community and was turning point in the lives of the community. He encouraged them to convert to Buddhism, and after Govindada's conversion, many people followed the suit. Pawar describes a displaying of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's photo alongside the photo of Buddha in many Dalit establishments. Pawar's autobiography highlighted Dr. B.R. Ambedkar as one of the few feminists of the community, and few women that were privileged to work with him turned to writing and documenting. So writes about how initiation into Buddhism transformed the community. The autobiography highlights both the tribulations of everyday existence of Dalit women and the double standards with patriarchy, both within the family and the community. Her father displayed double standards, where to the world he was a reformer, but to his family he was abusive and patriarchal. In this context, one finds parallels to black feminist writing. For neither in the black emancipation movement nor in the Dalit one, there was any place for women's rights, and women's voices were erased by the larger Dalit movement, led and articulated by the Dalit men. Reading through Ayodhan poses a troubling question on the manner in which access to an experience of education is structured around the lines of caste, gender and class. Urmila Pawar's experience of schooling reveals the everyday discrimination faced by the students of a particular caste. Her observation of the differences between her and the Brahmin girls in the school reflects a pain faced by many in their everyday life. Thus, one could observe that Pawar's views on education were shaped by the largely discriminatory schoolmates and teachers who humiliated her due to a lack of proficiency in English. In general, a large hurdle to Dalit feminist development was and remains lack of education. Another similar incident was when writer Kumud Pavade wanted to take up Sanskrit in school and was discouraged by her upper caste teachers. Despite the implementation of plenty of literary programs in India, number of literate Dalit women remains abysmally low. Other than Pawar, many other examples of autobiography inclined works have also appeared on accounts of illiterate Dalit women and their life experiences. Marital life also forms an integral part of the autobiography. Pawar recounts the happiness she experienced upon receiving her first salary and the pang she felt when she had to surrender it to her husband in turn, thus establishing her dependency on someone else. Her home life, her relationship with her husband would also become a sensitive issue throughout her life. Her husband Harish Chandra also faced much discrimination in the village, so he heeded Ambedkar's call to work in the city. Pawar notes that here, that self-respect comes more readily to a man than it comes to a woman. She has to spend years and years reading books and participating in college events to gain her self-respect. Here she cites the effect of Dr. Ambedkar and other Dalit writers had upon her. This was the most significant period developmentally as she could pursue writing along with her job in Mumbai. She developed friendships with women and she shared her experiences which spurred her to write. At home, however, the subject of her master's degree was a source of much difficult to her husband as he did not want to feel inferior. Her family remained ambivalent to the subject and her very traditional husband expected her to take care of her household chores and the children. She found solace in Maitrini, an organization she was inducted into by her friend. She was also invited to read her short stories to larger audiences and began to make contacts with prominent women in literary circles. She soon began to share stages with noted personalities. Pawar observed here that there was a difference between the titles and honors conferred upon men and women. Men had Bhau Sahib or Rao Sahib attached to the name, while women were simply addressed with the suffix Bhai. She felt insulted due to this distinction and thus raised the question of self-respect among women. Pawar went on to write much more and made considerable strides in her field by writing a biography of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and becoming an eminent name in the literary circle. She looked towards writing as a means to escape a less than satisfactory personal life and continually looked at her mother's weaving as a source of inspiration for her autobiography. As Pawar's awareness of feminism developed, she was of the opinion that both women and men should be looked upon as exactly equal. The number of rights available to a man must also be available to a woman. Unfortunately, the Dalit movement was indifferent to the women and refused to give women more space in the community. And at the same time, the women's liberation movement failed to take into consideration the Dalit suffering into account. This particular brand of feminism referred to by Anupama Rao as Brahminical feminism was at best woefully unaware of Dalit interest. Pawar viewed her consciousness as a result of Phule Ambedkarite influences and reflected upon the name Dalit as being that of a rational humanistic category that faced centuries of oppression and a place within this identity. She ends her memoir with a heartrending description of her widow's plight during her husband's funeral and opposition to the oppressive ritual, with her acceptance of the harsh realities of life that the Dalit women have to face regularly. One must note that there is a constant conflict in Urmila Pawar's life between her community and the family, which expected her to act in a certain way, and a conscience which was in solidarity with the women's liberation movement and Ambedkar's progressive views. Another source of conflict was between her activism for her Dalit women's rights and her affiliation with more Brahmin-dominated groups. What differentiates her writing from that of the other Dalit feminist writers is a constant reference to her personal experiences with community playing a large role. Sharmila Regia observed that this should be viewed exclusively as a historical narrative of experiences, similarly due to the fact that this has been an account of Pawar's unique personal experiences as a Dalit woman. Section 3. Dalit Women and Citizenship Rights. Patil maintains that in order to examine the position of Dalit women in this context, it is important to take into consideration the intersections of citizenship and gender. Due to their existence in a developing post-colonial society, Dalits have been subjected to its tensions in addition to their initial struggles. In the post-globalized world, their identities and by extension social security are subject to gradual decay. Unskilled Dalits, the author notes, due to this have little or no ability to form networks and to navigate the landscape of a largely skilled exclusionary society. Drawing from Rege, Patil argues that Dalit women are at the bottom rung of the social ladder, especially as they are oppressed by non-Dalit women, non-Dalit men and Dalit men, therefore experiencing triple forms of oppression. They are offered little to no political representation because initially most political parties are based on Brahminical ideologies and marginalized Dalit concerns. Moreover, complex webs of politicized Dalit organizations find little place for representation of Dalit women. Thus, Patil argues that patriarchal structures within and without Dalit community are the root causes for their suffering. Aside from a systematic lack of facilities and proper social security, Dalit women are victims of harsh abuse and symbolic and physical violence. Many Dalit voices, despite the oppression, challenge the question of citizenship and attempt to find their own places within it. Additionally, it is important to recognize that disrespect of Dalit women is also a fallout of Dalit patriarchy, where atrocities against Dalit women act as extensions of caste-related practices that questions the self-respect of the Dalit women. The dreadful atrocities on Dalit women, as observed at Khailanji, the sexual violence inflicted on Priyanka and Surekha Bhutmange on 29 September 2006, demonstrate the violence against assertion of Dalit women. Thus, Patil argues that the rural caste conflict that perpetuated OBCs and Dalits was mediated through the suppression of the Dalit women's voices. In the context of such violence, it is important to analyze the intervention of the state to deal with the violence inflicted against Dalits. Kannabiran states that Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes Prevention Atrocities Act 1989 recognizes the gendered nature of caste experience, especially for the Dalit women. An important organization that provides a platform for Dalit women is the formation of National Federation of Dalit Women in 1995. The manifesto includes establishing a separate identity from the autonomous women's movement in India and the male-dominated secular and progressive movement, including the Dalit movement and progressive movement. It also highlights the need for critical reflection on caste-based discrimination and the violence inflicted on Dalit women. Kannabiran analyzes the manifesto to state that such a framework will enable women to address its expressions, diversity and locate themselves in the specific regional and historical context while at the same time preserve their identity and specificity. Even if one focuses on the title of the manifesto of the National Federation of Dalit Women, Transforming Pain into Power aptly reflects a growing political articulation of the Dalit woman's experience of pain and tribulations into a powerful radical political identity. The NFDW argues that it is necessary to focus on the intersectionality of gender, race, caste in order to fully understand Dalit woman's location, as Dalit women are Dalits among Dalits because they are thrice alienated on the basis of caste, class and gender.
In this module on Dalit feminism, we have come to three major conclusions or three major arguments. First is that we need to develop a gendered sociological critique of philosophy and come to a point of developing Dalit feminist philosophy. Further, we have also looked into the whole idea of Dalit feminism, especially in terms of its understanding as it is feminist, non-patriarchal. Further, we have looked into how the whole idea of Dalit feminism has given us an idea that when you look at Dalit in terms of his caste experiences, it is everyday resistance against casteism, exclusion, which is minute, persistent, cumulative and intense. So therefore, we need to understand the varied understanding of Dalit feminist standpoint and develop a sociological and a gender critique in terms of an understanding of how women's movement in India have failed to interrogate with the idea of Dalit feminism.